intellectual and active groups. You might see them around campus, denouncing capitalism, praising capitalism. It all depends on which group you haven't bumped into. To my left, we have Logic, today represented by Arthur, the CEO, Kenneth, its president, and Chad, who's also another officer within the club. Logic is a philosophical club here at UCLA, which is centered around the political and economic philosophies of the 20th century philosopher Ayn Rand. Rand is the creator of objectivist philosophy, which I think many in the room here today have heard about and read about within their educational experiences. And to my right, we have the LaRouche Political Action Committee, today represented by Cody and Skye. Both Cody and Skye are members of the Democratic Central Committee in Los Angeles, and are also members of the Democratic State Central Committee of California. The LaRouche Political Action Committee is centered around the political and economic philosophies of the very controversial 20th century thinker named Lyndon LaRouche. I ask both our debaters today to please keep time. If you go over time, I'll unfortunately have to cut you off. I'll be giving time signals during the debate, 5 minutes, 4 minutes, 3 minutes, and then, of course, during your last 10 seconds, I'll be raising my hands like this. Well, enjoy the debate, and hopefully this will be an educational experience for us all.
You want to go over the format?
To give you guys a brief overview of the format of today's debate, we'll be starting with a 10-minute opening by Logic, with then a 5-minute cross-examination between both groups. Then we'll be having a 17-minute opening and rebuttal by the LaRouche Political Action Committee, followed by another 5-minute cross-examination between both groups. And then throughout the course of the debate, we'll be having 7-minute speeches by both teams until the debate will ultimately end with 10-minute closings by both teams. Great, let's begin.
Thousands of years ago, the first man discovered how to make fire. He was probably burned at the stake he had taught his brothers to light. He was considered an evildoer who had dealt with a demon mankind dreaded. But thereafter, men had fire to keep them warm, to cook their food, to light their caves. He had given them a gift they had not conceived, and he had lived to darken himself the earth. Centuries later, the first man invented the wheel. He was probably torn in the rack he had taught his brothers to build. He was considered a transgressor who ventured into forbidden territory. But thereafter, men could travel past any horizon. He had left them a gift they had not conceived, and he had opened the roads of the world. That man, the unsubmissive and first, stands in the opening chapter of every legend mankind has recorded about his beginnings. Prometheus was chained to a rock and torn by vultures because he had stolen the fire of the gods. Adam was condemned to suffer because he had eaten the fruit from the tree of knowledge. Whatever the legend, somewhere in the shadows of its memory, mankind knew that his glory began with one, and that that one paid for his courage. Throughout the centuries, there were men who took the first steps down new roads armed with nothing but their own vision. Their goals differed, but they all had this in common, that the step was new, the road was the first one, the vision unborrowed, and the response they received, hatred. The great creators, the thinkers, the artists, the scientists, the inventors, stood alone against the men of their time. Every great thought was opposed. Every great new invention was denounced. The first motor was considered foolish. The airplane was considered impossible. The power loom was considered vicious. Anesthesia was considered sinful. But the men of unborrowed vision went ahead. No creator was prompted by a desire to serve his brothers, for his brothers rejected the gift he offered, and that gift destroyed the slothful routine of their lives. His truth was his only motive, his own truth, and his own work to achieve it in his own way. A symphony, a book, an engine, a philosophy, an airplane, or a building, that was his goal in his life. Not those who heard, read, operated, believed, flew, or inhabited the thing he had created. The creator, the creation, not its users. The creation, not the benefits others derived from it. The creation which gave form to his truth. He held his truth above all things and against all men. His vision, his strength, his courage came from his own spirit. A man's spirit, however, is in itself, that entity which is his consciousness. To think, to feel, to judge, to act are functions of the ego. The creators were not selfless. It is the whole secret of their power, that it was self-sufficient, self-motivated, self-generated, a first cause, a fount of energy, a life force, a prime mover. The creator served nothing and no one. He had lived for himself. And only by living for himself was he able to achieve the things which are the glory of mankind, such as the nature of achievement. Man cannot survive except through his mind. He comes to earth unarmed. His brain is his only weapon. Animals obtain food by force. Man has no claws, no fangs, no horns, no great strength of muscle. He must plant his food or hunt for it. To plant, he needs a process of thought. To hunt, he needs weapons, and to make weapons, a process of thought. From the simplest necessity to the highest religious abstraction, from the wheel to the skyscraper, everything we are and everything we have comes from a single attribute of man, the functioning of his reasoning mind. But the mind is an attribute of the individual. There is no such thing as a collective brain. There is no such thing as a collective thought. We can divide a meal among many men. We cannot digest it in a collective stomach. No man can use his lungs to breathe for another man. No man can use his brain to think for another. All the functions of body and spirit are private. They cannot be shared or transferred. That quote was from Ayn Rand's The Fountainhead, where the protagonist, Howard, works. It symbolically stands trial for the alleged crimes of capitalism. He opened his defense by describing the nature of the productive man, a creator. He then announced the types of societies that have thus far existed on Earth, societies full of parasites, mediocrities, power-lusters, and cowards, all of whom denounced and hated the producer and his wealth, but hypocritically took advantage of it at every turn. Now, when one utters the word capitalism, many ideas come to mind. Capitalism is a system of competition, say some. Capitalism is a system of wealth, say others. Capitalism exploits the poor, say its opponents. Capitalism serves society better than any other system, say its supposed champions. These descriptions and accusations certainly are true of capitalism, but they represent definitions by non-essentials. What is capitalism at its root? These describe capitalism's effects. What are its causes? Man survives by his mind. He discovers the facts of reality and adapts them to serve his needs and wants. A primitive man must discover what plants are nutritious and which are poisonous. He must discover the principles of agriculture. He must discover how to fashion weapons and how to hunt. But life is more than just rote survival. Man pursues not just mere existence, but joyful experience. Man pursues happiness, satisfaction, his overarching self-interest. In nature, man faces a fundamental alternative, produce or die. The requirements of production is thinking, exercising independent rational judgment. His judgment may be right or wrong, and reality rewards or punishes him accordingly. Man's nature does not change when he lives among other men. In a society, man must still be able to practice the results of his own independent judgment. This requires the establishment of a non-contradictory set of absolute prerogatives. Prerogatives of acting upon one's own independent judgment, provided that such actions do not infringe on the prerogatives of others. The only way to establish the system of rights is to ban the initiation of force, that no man may initiate force against the person or property of others. This is the nature, the root of capitalism. It allows for voluntary interaction and bans coercion. As a result, individuals compete for the association services of others. Individuals create wealth, since every interaction is to mutual benefit, relative to previous circumstances and alternatives. Individuals exploit one another, since producers bribe consumers with products, and consumers exploit the producer's ingenuity and productive ability. And as a consequence, not a justification, the entire society prospers. It should be made clear that we do not live under capitalism today. Indeed, we live in a mixed economy of sorts, where there are capitalistic elements mixed with statism, that is, good compromise with evil. The extent to which America has been prosperous is precisely the extent to which it has been capitalistic, and vice versa. Under capitalism, a government is required to protect individual rights and to rectify their violation. Under capitalism, a government has no more right to initiate force than any of its citizens, which is not at all. A capitalist government does not redistribute the wealth of its citizens. It protects the right of each citizen to create and amass his own wealth. It requires that each citizen takes responsibility for himself. It does not force anyone to be his brother's keeper. Capitalism allows man to face reality qua man. It does not shield him from his actions' effects. Fundamentally, the argument for capitalism is philosophical. It is based on man's rights. What would an economic analysis yield? Men pursue their values. Under capitalism, men interact voluntarily, so the only reason to interact with other men is to obtain a value. Each party to a transaction sees it in his own interests. Otherwise, he is free to abstain. In such a society, every transaction results in mutual gain. Everybody in society is getting richer, which is good for each individual. There is no conflict. Granted, some get richer faster than others, and wealth gaps will increase, but the poor are still getting richer, to the extent of their abilities and ambition. Now, society as such does not value. Society is not an entity. It does not have wants, needs, goals, or ambitions. There are only the individuals of society. Individuals value. They want, need, aspire, create, produce, think. Society does not have interests. Individuals do. The only honest way to say that something is in society's interest is to say that it is also in each individual's interests. But too often, the justification of public good, social gains, or general welfare results in the momentary benefit of some individuals at the expense of others, but always results in long-term detriment of all. These types of policies are always harmful and are in fact anathema to capitalism. Instead of allowing individuals to create and operate by natural incentives, the government distorts incentives, turning value into non-value, and vice versa. It rewards incompetence. It punishes success. It destroys wealth. Instead of protecting the absolute right to private property and to voluntary association, the government grants exclusive franchises, establishes coercive monopolies, subsidizes industries that can't survive by appealing to consumers' desires, restricts and regulates the whim of pressure groups, lobbyists, special interests, unions, and corporate donors. When the government interferes in the economy, it is a travesty. It is a violation of individual rights that, not coincidentally, results in a whole host of problems for everyone. Consider one of a myriad of examples, rent control. Instead of allowing landlords to discover for themselves the most efficient allocation of their resources by adjusting prices according to what the market can bear, rent control violates the rights of landlords to do with their property as they wish. Because there's no such thing as a right to housing, there's only the right to create or trade for it, it is only by violating landlords' property that rent control can supposedly benefit renters. But does it even do that? Rent control limits the profit that landlords can amass. Not only does this punish their success, their ability to identify and invest in an industry that will yield a good return, but it limits their ability to invest their profit in further development. A capitalist does not fill swimming pools with gold coins a la Scrooge McDuck. He invests his exuberant profits in new ventures, creating even more wealth for himself and, consequently, for others. Similarly, property developers invest their profits in developing more rental units. But how can they do this with rent control limiting their profits? It gets worse. Because rent control makes rent artificially low, many more people will want to rent than there will be available units, resulting in long lines, waiting periods, ultimately lost time, resources, and investments. You may say, but everyone wants a place to live. This is true, but does everybody want a particular place to live if it costs a great deal? They may seek out less expensive alternatives, and the market adjusts. Everybody may fancifully want a palace in the sky, but that is not the same thing as economic demand. Such is the pattern with all such social programs. The government violates the rights of some individuals for supposed benefit of others. But ultimately, everybody loses out. The government destroys incentives, destroys wealth, creates and encourages poverty. There is no social program that is without aggregate and cascade effects. Our opponents may propose a variety of justified government controls or interventions, whether it is to help the poor, ensure fair competition, or some other so-called desirable goal. But one cannot legislate goals into being. One cannot have effects without causes. There is no alternative to facts of reality. There is only one way to ensure that private resources are used efficiently. There's only one way to ensure that rights are not violated. There's only one way to reward reason. There's only one way to discourage rationality. Capitalism bans initiation of force, of citizens against one another and the government against the citizens. It bans the intrusion of government to private consensual affairs. It bans the mixture of economy and state. Capitalism is a system of reason. Capitalism is a system of prosperity. Capitalism is a system of and for man. Thank you.
We're going to have a cross-examination period between LaRouche and Logic. I remind all debaters that during this period, LaRouche will be limited to the right to ask questions, while Logic limited to the right to answer them.
All right, perfect. This is kind of the first way. It's good because I thought that I have a question about the format. Because I noticed that in all of Rand's stories, at least the ones I'm familiar with, all of her arguments have to take the form of a fantasy story in order to justify it. You have to figure out, I know there's a lot of things you can make true in a fictional story. And you began with the same thing, two fictional stories about the wheel and fire. Do you have any real-world examples of what you're talking about?
In fact, we're not, the philosophy that we're using does not rely upon Ayn Rand's fictional works. There are quite a few non-fictional works that very well justify what we say, but regardless, we're not appealing to authority to say that Ayn Rand said so, so here it is. As far as real-world examples, we can talk about results of different kinds of economic policies and what they've done in the past, but ultimately, if you start with correct philosophical premises and perform logic on them, you will get to correct conclusions in philosophy. So as far as anything that you may challenge us on, if it's true or false or real-world examples, by all means, try to point out an error in our logic, and we can respond.
Although I'd like to add that an outstanding example of the failure time and time again of government regulation in the economy was the rent control example Arthur gave in his opening.
Do you think it's possible to have correct reason or correct logic with incorrect premises?
That's a contradiction in terms. Logic is a non-contradictory integration of sensory and conceptual data. So you cannot pretend to apply symbolic logic to premises and think that you're going to get to a correct conclusion. if you want to challenge our premises, by all means, but...
So you need some real example. If you're going to have a, whatever your logical method is, you need to have some real example you're discussing, something in the real world, not something in the fantasy world.
We haven't discussed anything about the fantasy world. I used abstractions to discuss the issue at hand. What I relied upon was man's nature and how man faces reality, and how that necessitates certain actions by man on his own, and consequently the types of actions that are required of man in society, and what proper social interactions are.
So I'd like an example of the first point you began with, about how all human creativity, all human discoveries, were based not on any kind of sense of discovery of a hunt for truth, developing human society, but rather on greed. Are there any real examples of that, and not a hypothetical that we can't figure out about, like the wheel or fire?
Sure. Bill Gates does not create Microsoft because he wishes to, help people with computers. Instead, Bill Gates wants to make billions of dollars, and I would dare say he's rather successful at that. He's motivated by his own self-interest. That doesn't mean that self-interest requires trampling over other people in the sense that you violate their rights. You don't trample over piles of corpses to achieve your ends, as I've described. You can't initiate force. But it does mean that people are acting toward their own interests, and in so doing, they factor in other people's interests in economic activity. After all, producers have to bribe consumers with something.
Is there anything that would cause you to include Bill Gates? And because you began your list with a list of fundamental discoveries, things that seem like they're crucial for humankind, why would you include Bill Gates as something that's crucial for human development, or do you?
Well, what exactly are you going to say is a need? And man does not need anything except a cave, a cloth, and a piece of meat. But man's life is not just about survival. Man's life is about living it to the fullest because we have the capability to do so, to enjoy it, to experience happiness. So, we don't really need fire or the wheel either. Microsoft Windows or the airplane, or you fill in the blank, these microphones, tables, chairs, anything. All these things are for people to satisfy their wants. And in some sense, their need to fulfill their happiness.
Well, I'd like to point out that, do you think the inventors of the airplane weren't humanists?
I'm not saying that one has to loathe humanity in order to be a self-interested individual. Self-interested individuals are actually the most generous and benevolent individuals of all, if, in fact, they practice self-interest rationally. One is not motivated primarily by helping others, although one realizes that that is the consequence of their action. You know.
And in fact, I'd like to say...
All right. That's time. LaRouche will now have 2 minutes of preparation period before they begin their speech, if they wish to take it.
I just have a question, though. With the 10-minute opening and 7-minute rebuttal, are you going to run that as one continuous 17 minutes?
Yeah, it is. It's one 17-minute speech, 10 minutes for an opening, 7 minutes for rebuttal. But you can apply it however you want.
Okay.
Often, in Laputian halls of academia, one will run into various groups of young men and women, students and teachers, engaged in the age-old practice of master debating. And time again, those master debaters, as is true to the practice itself, willfully commit the folly of negating the most fundamental of all principles, that being reality. Now, we being a movement whose sole mission is to intervene into reality, historical reality, we find a lot of contention in what's being presented by our logicians here. Now, what we represent as a movement is a movement which has been committed for the last 35 years, but as a youth movement for the last 6 years, to a thorough investigation of the science of history and the history of science. Now this is the foundation of all those ideals which LaRouche has put forward in his science of economy, of physical economy. Now it should be noted that the debate that we're engaging in here actually took place well over 225 years ago in the establishment of this republic, the Declaration of our Independence, and the formation of our Constitution. Now, if people really think through and take into mind those principles embedded within our own Constitution and hold those against the ideas being put forward by logic, one will see very easily that were we to adopt the ideals of logic, we'd have to dissolve our republic and abolish our Constitution. Now, let's go into a bit of LaRouche's ideas of physical economy. Now, where he starts is the role of the individual creative discoverer. But for anyone who's actually engaged in a rigorous study of the actual minds who have made those discoveries, such figures like Johannes Kepler, people should be familiar with Kepler, the founder of the idea, the discoverer of the idea that the planets travel in elliptical orbits around the sun, discoverer of the principle of universal gravitation, a real discovery in the real universe, which has gone to great lengths to promote the development and advancement of mankind. Now go back and, in fact, read the works of Johannes Kepler, not something that you got out of your professor's textbook or something you looked up on the internet or Wikipedia or one of these things, but actually go back. And if you're capable, read it in the original German or Latin. But look at what Kepler himself actually says about why he made his discovery. The man was first and foremost absolutely committed to humanity. He was committed to creating a future which was better than the reality which he currently existed in. And it's absolutely clear in the works of people like Kepler, Benjamin Franklin, Gottfried Leibniz, Einstein. I mean, these were men of science who were committed to the future and committed to humanity itself. And so it's from this standpoint, from the investigation of the actual minds of the shapers of history, that LaRouche has developed his discoveries in the domain of physical economy, of investigating the role of the individual discoverer in confronting a true ontological paradox in the universe, and applying that uniquely human quality of hypothesis formation to discover some new and yet unknown universal principle. And then testing that principle in reality. Saying when mankind discovers, assimilates, and acts upon this discovered principle, what are the effects to mankind? If it's a truthful discovery, the effects will be measured in terms of something known as potential relative population density. Does this discovery, when applied to the human species, increase mankind's power to exist and flourish within our real universe? That's the only true metric for an honest discovery in this universe. And so it's from that standpoint that Lyndon LaRouche had developed his discoveries, his own unique discoveries, in the domain of physical economy. Now, if you go back and you investigate the internal history of our own United States, the history of where the idea of the nation state developed from, dating back to the France of Louis XI, Henry VII of England, going back to the Florentine Renaissance, back to the era of Plato's Republic, and you look at then the application and development of those principles in our own United States, that's the only place where you can truly discover and understand a real idea of physical economy. Now what we want to look at is what is in fact the reality that we face today. Now to understand what's happening now, you have to understand something fundamental that took place in 1971. This is whenever Nixon put a final nail in the coffin of the Bretton Woods system that had been developed by Franklin Roosevelt and his collaborators, where you had a fixed exchange rate system He had a commitment on behalf of the federal government for investment into national infrastructure projects, development projects. People saw this during the World War II era as that which got us out of the Great Depression. Things like the TVA project, where we were able, through federal intervention, to raise a portion of the nation which existed in 18th century type squalor and bring them up to a 20th century standard of living. All done through the efforts of the intervention of the federal government by the hands of one Franklin Roosevelt. Now in 71, whenever Nixon decoupled the dollar from gold and established the floating exchange rate system, and then you had a succession of the introduction of the kind of legislation that these gentlemen would argue for, massive deregulation, deregulation of airlines, deregulation of the rail system, deregulation of trucking, a cutting of subsidies for farmers, deregulation of banking, deregulation of healthcare. All of that which most people see now as the leading ills of the world, and particularly in the United States, all came about at the hands of those very deregulatory policies that our friends in logic would probably find most beautiful. Now, what we've seen is we've got ourselves in a position now where this United States, and consequently the world, are teetering on the edge of the largest financial and economic blowout the world has ever seen. If you look what's occurring right now in the banking system, where you've got banks, JP Morgan and others, Chase Manhattan, the largest banks in the world, have about a 10-to-1 portfolio ratio of derivatives to assets. Meaning for every $1 of assets that any one of these banks has, they've got $10 in derivatives obligations, debt obligations, surmounting upwards of $100 billion to $11 trillion. Now, what this has brought us to is that because of what you're seeing with the collapse of Delphi, the once second largest producer of auto manufacturing, GM, now going bankrupt, nearly 2 million manufacturing jobs lost in the United States under the Bush administration. You've got what we've seen in Louisiana, the effects of Katrina, where due to an immediate lack of preparedness and a failure of response on the part of the Bush administration, but also because of 25, 30 plus years of disinvestment into infrastructure, you have an entire city of the United States wiped off the face of the map. These are the effects of free trade policies, of deregulation. I mentioned derivatives. Look what happened back in 1997. Alan Greenspan himself, who many people might know, a protege and sometimes lover of Ayn Rand, had to acknowledge that in 1997 we nearly lost the entire financial system when long-term capital management went belly up, where $3 billion of liquidity was leveraged into nearly $6 trillion, and the whole thing nearly went under. And at that point, Alan Greenspan had to take emergency action to intervene. This is the Federal Reserve Chairman intervening artificially to pull together the heads of the leading banks around the world to pull together $3.5 billion to bail out long-term capital management before the thing blew up. And now we've got a situation worse today than what we faced in 1997. So that's the reality. You've got massive unemployment sweeping the globe. You've got wars ravaging Afghanistan, ravaging Iraq. We've got all kinds of smaller surrogate wars throughout Africa, throughout South America, Southeast Asia. You've got a planet on fire right now. And all of this has been at the hands of an increased movement towards deregulation, towards free trade, and towards globalization. Now, what Lyndon LaRouche is proposing right now, what we're fighting for right now within the Democratic Party, has been one, we've got to remove the roadblock to a real solution. And the face of that roadblock right now is Dick Cheney. And as we've been successfully able to do is you've got Cheney on the ropes. Look, Libby was brought down. Cheney's going to be the next to go. You clean these guys out, all of a sudden you've got a new potential within the United States to move with the kind of legislation that LaRouche has proposed. That you've now got people like Senator Harry Reid moving on. That has the Republicans a bit freaked out to the point where the head of the RNC was forced to acknowledge that Harry Reid had a LaRouche moment whenever he said there's a dark cloud hanging over the White House, and that dark cloud is Dick Cheney. So in removing Dick Cheney and then leading a fight within the Senate, we can once again bring the United States back to the direction that we were moving under Franklin Roosevelt, who, by the way, his inspiration for those very protectionist policies that he used to save us from the Great Depression and to defeat what was a real fascist movement within the United States was him acting as an echo of his great-grandfather, Isaac Roosevelt, a follower of Alexander Hamilton. Now, this is exactly, those policies are exactly what Lyndon LaRouche is proposing that we introduce today. A regulation of the banking system, a move to take the current financial system and put it through a kind of bankruptcy reorganization, where we'd be wiping out trillions of dollars of faulty debt, not only in the third world, but in the United States itself. And then what we would do is act with the power of the federal government to create tens of trillions of dollars of credit to invest into infrastructure projects, nuclear power, high-speed maglev rail, water systems, other forms of transportation systems, move the United States back into becoming the world's leading manufacturing nation on the planet of high-end, capital-intensive technology, which we would not only produce to facilitate the massive redevelopment of the United States, but which we would use to carry out a massive exporting of this high-end technology into the so-called developing sectors to facilitate their development of the first world standards. And in fact, it's only through this kind of a policy that this United States and consequently the world are going to be able to move out of this current collapse. Now, the effects of doing such things is that you would create the necessary conditions of life that would allow those sovereign minds, those sovereign individuals around the planet, the opportunity to develop their creative potentials to meet the demands of humanity for the future. I mean, who here is to say that what you've got right now in Africa, under the right conditions, are not potentially the next genius who may make the discovery for the cure of AIDS, the cure of cancer, may make the necessary breakthroughs that would lead to an affordable development of fusion energy technology? But to understand how that's going to happen, you have to actually go back and examine reality. What's the reality of how humanity has achieved the level of success that we have achieved up to this point? It hasn't been through free trade. It hasn't been through globalization. It's been through the sovereign nation state acting to defend the general welfare of its people and their posterity. The future. That's the reality. Look at the greatest periods of economic growth in the United States itself. Look at the period in the 1960s coming out of the Civil War, following on the heels of Lincoln with the policies of people like Matthew and Henry Carey, where the United States developed the Transcontinental Railroad not as a private project, but through government-generated credit, moving into the 1876 Centennial Convention, where on display were the greatest developments in steam engine technology and other sorts of technology, which then you had the leaders from Germany, from Japan, from Russia, from South America, coming to the Centennial Convention in Philadelphia, inspired by those ideas, and then imported the American system of political economy. A system that's been largely written out of the history books today. That system, as it was known by people like Hamilton and Cavalier, as the American system of political economy. It was neither free trade capitalist, nor communist, or socialist, or anything like that. And it was that which Bismarck used to develop Germany. It was responsible for the Meiji Restoration in Japan. And any time it's been applied, as most recently done by Franklin Roosevelt, it's been successful. Time and time again, it's been tested and proven to be the only successful model of economic development in history. And I challenge these guys to come up with concrete historical cases where the application of pure free trade deregulation has ever produced an ounce of good for humanity. Mm-hmm.
All right, we'll have another cross-examination period with the logic team asking questions.
You mentioned a lot the term political economy. Could you please describe exactly what that means?
Yeah. I mean, you can't really separate economics from politics, because economics is always something which has taken place amongst political entities. Nation states, quasi-nation states, colonies, what have you. So we're talking about political economy. We're looking at the way in which government acts to organize the flow of materials, of energy, of people, to the effect of developing its nation and its people. That these are always done as political policies.
You also use the term relative population density as kind of the criterion for... Potential relative population densities. Could you please also explain what that is and why it's a good criterion for judging a program success or failure?
Okay, so what we're looking at is that if in fact it's the creative powers of the individual human mind which are responsible for human advancement, then what we're looking at is, given a relative land area, say some square kilometers of land area, and it's going to be relative because not all land area is created equal. So given your relative land area and the technologies that exist at the time, the know-how that exists at the time, what are the number of people that you can support in that given land area relative to the land and relative to the technologies that are available to mankind at that time?
Support by what standard?
Support by standards of education, healthcare, life expectancy.
Well, yes, I mean, those are all categories, but like standard, like what quality of education, like what are you talking about when you say standards of education?
What's the potential that you've created for those individuals in that area to themselves contribute to the further development of mankind?
I'm not exactly clear how you're trying to mix individualism and some sort of, I mean, essentially this collectivism. How?
Yeah, it's
what
paradoxical.
Well, right. This is why I don't understand why you're talking about the individual welfare of every person in some given geographic region instead of, I mean, you're mixing this individualistic aspect with using society as a standard for what is right or wrong. I'm not clear where you're basing any idea of rights. I mean, do rights come from man's nature, or do they come from how a society happens to function? I mean, what are the objective criterions upon which you justify that potential relative population density is the correct metric?
Yeah, well, those rights to man are inherent. If the nature of man is that man is the only creature capable of discovering those unsensible principles
what
which
rights,
govern
though?
The way that our universe develops.
What rights, though? Could you please specify, like, what principle rights are based on? Like, what was the... Give me a statement, like, rights are blank. Like, what are rights? And where do they come from?
Well, your rights come from God, I guess you could say. But not to get mixed up in religion, we speak of God, we mean that your rights are inherent to the nature of man, that you have the right to develop that which is of your essence. That's what
okay. Let me just be a little more direct.
Getting at it. When I was saying that man, if man is in fact the only creature which is able to discover universal principles, such as Kepler's discovery of universal gravitation, if that's the essence of what distinguishes man as man from any other creature on this planet, then your inherent right as man is a right to have that quality fostered and developed to the effect that you can exercise it.
Okay, thank you. You said in your speech that one of your goals is to like wipe out third world debt. Exactly how do you plan to do that? Just by saying it no longer exists? Or?
Yeah, you bring together a consort of nations.
Thank you, I think I understand.
No, I don't think you do. What you do is you bring together a consort.
Well, it's pretty simple.
This is actually what happened. This is why I say history is very important. If you look at what took place during the Bretton Woods Conference, you brought together heads of states who made...
I'm sorry, as we are running out of time, we should move on to one further question.
To reestablish a new
monetary system. You said that banks have illegitimate forms of debt, and you also want to eliminate those when you restructure banks. Could you please describe how you're going to do that briefly?
How we're going to do it?
Yes.
Again, it would be the role of the nation to act for its interests against the international banks. It's called sovereignty.
Okay, thank you very much.
Logic now has 2 minutes of preparation time if they wish to use it.
You want some water? Do you want some?
What?
I've been drinking it back. This is a good debate.
In this speech, I'd just like to address some of the main points brought up by the LaRouche group. First off, they keep talking about how the American system, as they call it, which is essentially just their brand of socialism, statism, whatever you want to call it, giving it the name the American system does not change its essence. What it is government intervention in the economy. It is telling private citizens what they can and cannot do with their own property. It is theft. It is wrong, flat out. Calling it cookies and milk does not make it sweet. Moving on to their point, what they said about the Constitution. They said that advocating the system that we do, we'd have to entirely wipe out the Constitution. That's entirely incorrect. There are certainly things that are wrong in the Constitution. The original Constitution allowed slavery, said women can't vote, etc., etc. Certainly there are things that are wrong with it, things that I would advocate if we rewrote it to change. And if I had to do it over, those are things I'd change. But the Constitution was very clear in its original document about a strict separation between government and the economy. It said individuals are their own thing, and the government largely needs to keep out of the way. I would make that more explicit and say there is a strict separation between government and economy if I were to rewrite it myself. But essentially, that is what the Constitution was there to do, to protect citizens from the government, to protect citizens from essentially what the LaRouche people are advocating. They also talk a lot about healthcare regulation, airline deregulation, etc. These were deregulated, and this was a wonderful thing. For instance, the problems, certainly we do have problems in the healthcare industry, and in many other industries, but the problems that stem in the healthcare industry are problems of government regulation. It is because there's not enough competition in the market, because that competition has been disallowed and stifled by government regulations, that we do not have enough competition and we do not have enough choices for healthcare and we do not have all the other things that would characterize a good healthcare system. They also talked about Hurricane Katrina and how this was a huge disaster and we need more government programs, more government aid, etc. Absolutely not. This should be the clearest point of all. Who was the last agency there? FEMA. Who was the first there? Walmart. Do you want to know why? Walmart had a profit motive to get there. They said, we're going to charge people $20 for a bottle of water. Yes, we're going to get there very quickly. And then when they show up, they're the first on the scene. What are they called? They're called evil, and they're called price gougers. Where's FEMA? Nowhere. FEMA is not there because it doesn't have any motive to be there. Other than, like, a revolt that would absolutely just oust the government and plant a new one, how is FEMA going to get negative feedback when it does something wrong? It doesn't. Unless the countries want to get together and just vote out the entire government, FEMA's not going to get the message that it's doing something wrong. Walmart will get the message that it's doing something wrong if Home Depot goes there first, because Walmart will lose out on millions or, you know, hundreds of millions or billions of dollars in profit. Walmart was there first because they saw a profit and leaped on it. That is the essence of the capitalist system. It's exploiting them, yes, absolutely, to their own benefit, to mutual benefit. People do not buy $20 bottles of water if they don't think it's in their interest. They want water. FEMA does not provide water, Walmart does. They also seem to allege that we support Bush-Cheney administration implicitly. That is not correct at all. Sure, they do some good things, I guess, like tax breaks. More power to them for that. But the Bush-Cheney administration has increased the federal deficit more than any other administration. And even when you don't consider war spending, they've still raised it more than most. They've given Medicare entitlements and all sorts of new government programs and subsidies to airlines, for instance, that logic wholeheartedly opposes. We are not just supporters of the Bush administration, and it's ridiculous to say that we are. They say that the policies of FDR have been the most successful throughout history. This is absolutely wrong. I'd like to point you to, I don't have the name of the study, but last year there was a study published by the UCLA economics department that actually came to the conclusion that, it's kind of interesting because the two economics grad students who were doing the study originally did the study to show that the policies of the New Deal helped us get out of the Depression. But the conclusion they came to was that FDR's policies prolonged the Depression by more than a decade. That if we had not instituted those policies, and if we had let the market forces work, if we had let people and businesses get the economy out of its depression just by market forces, by supply and demand, by offering products and services, rather than increasing the government's debt and just pouring money into an economy, that we would have gotten out of the depression a lot sooner. That's not a coincidence. When people have a financial interest in doing something, i.e. seeing a market and going after it, that's the best system for everyone. When you just hand people money, like we do it in Hurricane Katrina, they just say, here's a $2,000 check, rebuild something. What do? They go buy Louis Vuitton purses. They say that politics and economics are inextricably linked. That is only true to the extent that the government needs to butt out of the economy and say, we're going to enforce contracts and we're going to let you do all the rest. It is not the government's job to sit around and be the little nanny of everyone and say, you give him $2 for this and then you give him this. No, the government's job is merely to protect the economy from the government. The government's job is to make sure that if people have contracts, they're not violated, and that's it. That's it as far as economic intervention goes. It is not the government's job to take money, the hard-earned money of private citizens, and give it to whoever it thinks is going to use it best. Time and time again, it has been shown to not be the system that works best, as well as being entirely immoral, if you think of it as Bill Gates earning money, earning billions of dollars, and then having it just stolen from him every year by the IRS to give out to welfare recipients or whatnot. They bring up the fact that, Kepler, etc., and his colleagues were great altruists. They did things to help humanity. They didn't want this for themselves. They wanted to spread goodwill and better everyone. Well, only because they live in humanity. They didn't want to better Martian life. They didn't want to better some, extraterrestrial colony. They wanted to better life on Earth because they live on Earth. Kepler wanted a better system of philosophy, a better system of science, because he lives on Earth and benefits from that. He wanted that for him. Clearly, it's going to benefit everyone else, but he wants it for him because he lives here. That's why he doesn't, like I said, try to help aliens or help heaven or what other entity that he does not live in. He wants to help himself. Anyone who is a noteworthy person in society, Bill Gates, etc., was brought up earlier. Bill Gates wants money for himself. Sure, he gives a lot to charity, that's mostly for tax breaks, but he wants money for himself, and that's a very good thing.
LaRouche now has 2 minutes of cap period, if they wish to take it. And I'll also remind the audience that once the debate ends, there will be a 1 hour period of questioning for both LaRouche and LaRouche, where the audience can bring up any issues that they want to question about.
Okay. I'll stress again, I think what I'll go with, for the benefit of the people in the audience, our friends here in Logic, a mini 7-minute history lesson. Because it was clear, I guess, that nobody realized that we have in the past abolished third world debt before, We have in the past pushed for across-the-board regulation in the United States of the banking system. What LaRouche is calling for right now, for instance, the immediate drying up of the derivatives market as something, a useless cancer on the physical economy, this was also done. Every time you've ever had any kind of development in United States history, any kind of increase in the development of the productive goods that are necessary for all of human survival and the development of those skills that Cody described, what's more important than survival, giving every human being the capability to now act on society in a way that's useful, giving themselves an effective immortality. That was done using the policies that we're proposing. And I'd suggest anybody in here do a real thorough review of that period. Take a look, for instance, at what Roosevelt did with the development, bringing electricity into the rural areas of the United States. This was done in opposition to the power companies. The utilities fought Roosevelt every step of the way. The utilities whose job it was to provide electricity to the population refused to do so because they made more of a profit by not doing so, given the environment that had been set up under Coolidge and Hoover, the promotion of radical free trade policies, privatization. As soon as Roosevelt came in, Roosevelt bypassed the blockage that was coming from the utilities, the electrical utilities. Roosevelt forced the electrification of the Midwest, and in the process increased the not just the standard of living for the population, increased educational levels, giving the youth in these rural areas the opportunity to do something that was actually human for the society that they lived in. Roosevelt also incidentally increased the profits for the utility companies. And this is always the case. Any private entity exists in the medium that is a physical economy. You wouldn't have private entrepreneurs if it wasn't for the nation state. The development of the nation state is necessary in order to have anything that you might consider useful generated by private interests. The utilities, the electrical utilities that were gouging California during the energy crisis wouldn't have been able to do so if they couldn't live off the energy grid that was created by Roosevelt. The entirety of the physical structure that they looted from in order to make the profits they were making, Enron, Dynegy, Duke, Reliant, this was created during Roosevelt's period. Take a look, date back the development of the power plants, date back the development of the time we had the energy grid, the network of the energy grid laid out. All this was done by the nation state. And I think this kind of shows the problem of having a debate in the absence of any kind of real history. This is a problem with Rand in general, but this is a problem that you've got with everybody, every crucial debate that's being held on the campus right now in economics departments is organized so that you can present whatever argument you like by never having to actually take a scientific approach to what took place, to ever taking a scientific approach to history, economic policy, meaning that you're going to find specific cases, you're going to develop them, you're going to figure out what was successful about those, and you're going to test out what was done by an application of the current situation, which is what we're promoting in the LaRouche Youth Movement. The bulk of our research projects people can find in our science magazine, a science magazine website, you're welcome to take a look at that, which is 21stcenturyscienceandtechnology.com. The policy proposals that we've got on both our intelligence magazine website for the Executive Intelligence Review, which is LaRouchePAC.com, or the international development policies that we've got on our website for the Schiller Institute, theschillerinstitute.org. All of these policies are the kind of things that whatever tiny benefit might come from what logic is describing depends upon what you create in those areas. And again, I suggest a study of history in order to clarify some of those points, because it's really hard to have a philosophical debate in that kind of a vacuum, a historical philosophical vacuum. But
how much time do we have left?
2 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, I guess one thing that would be important to bring up is that it seems to be happening time and time again on the part of logic, is that they assert things of which they really don't have any real background in. Like, for example, my friend referenced Kepler, and he said, well, Kepler did this and that for that reason. I'd like to know which works of Kepler he's read.
or which biography of Kepler he read in order to be able to assert this about Kepler's life. And if the only thing that you can cite in reference to what happened with Roosevelt was some study done by a couple of UCLA grad students, I mean, there's got to be a little more rigor in applying, whenever we're investigating ideas of historic importance, when you're talking about life and death. And I'm also a little bit confused. It seems to me that whenever we brought up the Katrina, they referenced Walmart, and Walmart's going and charging $20 for a bottle of water because there was a profit motive involved. Is that to say that it would be okay if someone didn't have the $20, but yet they were dying of thirst, not to give them the bottle of water because there was no profit to be gained for you? Okay, I mean, if that's what you guys represent, that's a bit insane. I don't know if Adolf Hitler, I'm sure, would have been like that policy. So, I mean, I'd like to get some kind of response from these guys. Could you maybe give us an indication of some of the scientists that you read through their original works to where you actually know their mind and how it operated, that you can make the kind of assertions that you have? Are we done?
This is not a question you can ask.
Yeah, you got some time coming up.
All right, so some of the things that we end up debating are that philosophy is, in fact, an actual, rational, exact, and precise science. That philosophy is based on the most basic observations about reality, and on that basis, we come to conclusions and make derivations and discover, through a rational scientific method, what is good for an individual, and consequently, what is good for a society. Now, What the LaRouche movement advocates is essentially, you know, there are all these things that we don't like about society, and they make a very, you know, emotional argument. They bring up lots of things that everybody thinks are like really bad, and you know, but it's very superficial. It's mostly emotional. So what they want to do is they want to legislate into being certain goals. We don't like poverty. We'll outlaw it. We'll just have the government give people money, instead of discovering, for instance, what the necessities of production are and creating conditions that allow people to create profit for themselves, i.e. to allow them to engage in voluntary exchange and trade with other individuals, of course, to mutual benefit. Now, when they talk about all sorts of regulation, whether it's regulation of the electric industry or of medicine or whatever, this is not just like regulation of some, you know, floating abstraction industry. This is somebody's medical practice. This is somebody's electric industry, somebody's power plant. And the same thing goes for banks. It's someone's bank. Someone took risks. Someone had to invest. Someone invested their time, effort, money into creating a bank, and they expect to reap the profits. Why would somebody do something if they would gain nothing from it? Even the most, proud altruists, you know, who say, oh, I'm not doing this for me, I'm doing this for society, or for my neighbor, or for my child, or you fill in the blank. These people ultimately, are acting because, well, they either want to think of themselves as good, or they want other people to think of them as good, or they're under some deluded notion that they're going to someplace called heaven, or they don't want to get to hell, or you fill in the blank. The point is that biologically, everybody's motivated to do things for themselves. It is only what they realize on a conscious level that determines whether they're, be altruistic or egoistic. The point is that individuals are motivated on a very basic level to do good for themselves. They may be confused about how to achieve that. They may delude themselves into thinking they're doing it for society. Whatever. This is why we don't need to address the particulars of Kepler. Maybe they're right about, Kepler really did think he was doing good for society, but that's quite irrelevant. On a biological level, he must have been motivated by self-interest. This is how biological entities operate. You don't live by sacrificing the values required for life. It doesn't make any sense. Now, we also evade the question of where rights come from. We keep saying, rights come from human nature. We are individuals. To survive in reality, man must practice reason. He must be able to practice the results of his own independent judgment, which requires that other men do not initiate force against him, and particularly the government against him, since the government holds a great deal of force. a lot of power to exert force, I should say. So that is where rights come from. The initiation of force is wrong. The root right is a man may do whatever he wishes with himself and his property, provided he does not initiate force, fraud, or any such other corollary, which can be discussed in the Q&A section, provided he does not initiate force or fraud against any other person or his property. We can also discuss where property comes from in the Q&A. But the point is that these are the source of rights, man's nature. It has nothing to do with man and how he lives and, you know, and what is it, relative population density potential. I'm sorry, I don't remember the phrase. That's not me trying to slight them, I just honestly don't remember. The point is that people have rights, the government must protect those rights, not violate them. And certainly when the government interferes in the economy, it always creates distortions of incentives. The government is allowed. The government can coercively extort tax dollars and thereby distort the incentives associated with doing something. When someone owns private resources, they want to use the resources efficiently. They want to get something out of it. They want to use their resources in the manner that benefits them most. When the government provides free resources by extorting it from other people, it completely distorts free market incentives. You cannot have, a free market partway and have kind of regulation. Freedom is binary. You either have it or you don't. Just because the government says to its citizens, do whatever you wish for now, it's the same thing as slavery, you know, where certain slaves were allowed a little bit more autonomy than, you know, others. A slave master may say, do whatever you wish for now, but that person is still a slave. Now, as far as economic improvement throughout history, in pre-capitalist Europe, there was utter destitution. People subsisted on mere dollars a week, dollars by our standards today. And finally, when we went through the Enlightenment, we discovered principles of capitalism, of individual rights, etc. Conditions improved remarkably because these principles of governance were consistent with facts of reality, human nature. It was based on the exact science of philosophy. Now, granted, some of those people were still, you know, confused to some extent, but the point is that they were on the road to creating correct principles of governance. Now, when the United States was developed, when the United States came into being, we were particularly concerned about government encroachment on individual liberties. This is why we seceded from Britain. And over time, and in the very beginning, we had a great deal of autonomy, individuals, that is, and the economy flourished. We had many new inventions, light bulb, various, all sorts of rail industries, you name it. And even today, we're still moving on the coattails of that momentum. But as time goes on, we're regulating more and more. Sure, now and again, we deregulate this or that. But how many propositions on the last California special election were to create a new regulation or, create new special privileges for people, special people? Now the economy is going down. I agree. Things are going awry. But it's precisely because the government is interfering. And it is precisely in stark contrast to the principles upon which our government was founded. That is not the justification, but it so happens that those principles, in essence, if not in every particular, are what is correct for our government. Freedom.
Not have 2 minutes of preparation periods.
The issue of slavery was brought up. I think it should be duly noted that ignorance of reality and history is perhaps the worst form of slavery. And this is in fact the point that we want to continually keep coming back to. Is that what you've got is you have a distortion of reality and an ignorance of real history. The real history of ideas, the real history of science, the real history of our own United States. Now if you look at the principal founders of our nation, if you look at the first Treasury Secretary of the United States, Alexander Hamilton, he was an avid promoter of protectionism, of tariffs, of government regulation. If you look at the writings of Benjamin Franklin, again, he defended the rights of the nation to protect its people from the scourge of free trade and globalization. And so, in fact, this is exactly the idea that we're fighting to bring back now. Look at what you had. You talked about, okay, freedom from, what was it, freedom from individuals harming you or exerting force upon you. I wonder, is it considered an act of force whenever a company lays off its workforce to move its factory into a third world nation, where they exploit the labor? Or the reason why the cost of production is so cheap is because you've got often lack of running water, you've got lack of health care, you've got lower standard of living in general. And so it's due to the fact that the government and the population don't have to pay into maintaining a standard of living which is acceptable for the 21st century, that's why the cost of labor is so cheap. Now, is that an act of force? Sure, you may not be going up with a gun and telling the guy he's got to leave his job, but by moving the factory, you in effect create a condition where that individual and that family have lost their ability to maintain their mode of existence. And as that's happened, now ask again, are there laws currently in the United States that restrict, say, Bill Gates or any of these other billionaires from then employing those now unemployed skilled machinists into a new job that's going to give them the quality of life that they formerly had? No. So to say that deregulation, in fact, produces a greater benefit for mankind is a complete fallacy of composition. Historically, it's never occurred. You go back, you look at the period of enlightenment. Look at what happened in such areas like Ireland. Look what occurred as a result of free trade. Look at things like the potato famine. That was wholly the result of free trade economic practices. So this is the kind of system that is being advocated right now. It's a system which denies the right of the individual to a healthy human existence. And this is why, again, it is important that people go back and study history. Investigate the minds of those responsible for your own standard of living. Look at someone like Thomas Edison. Why did he do what he did? Why did Johannes Kepler die freezing in the cold trying to collect the last little bit of debt just to keep himself alive? This is a man who never saw the fruits of his labor. But if you actually read what the man said, he in fact did what he did because he was committed to a better future, to a better humanity. Martin Luther King, was this man an idiot because he was willing to sacrifice his own happiness, his own simple happiness, for a better future? He never got to fully see and realize the fruits of his work, and he knew what was going to happen. This man knew he was going to be killed, but yet he continued to do it because he was committed to something other than a profit motive. And so this is what we have to continually keep coming back to. What is the reality of our own nation? How did we come into existence? What was the battle? What did Fogel write whenever he was discussing the true idea of Leibnizian happiness? Because this was the works of Fogel is what they are reading in the Constitutional Convention, who was commenting on the works of Leibniz, who discussed what the idea of happiness was. The idea of happiness as the right to discover and transmit wisdom to others. To actually achieve a true immortality through the discovery of principles of truth and the communication of those into the future to create a better humanity. And this is what we're fighting for right now. Because if you look at where the world is, you've got famine, you've got war, you've got diseases running wild largely as a result of free trade. Look at the new bird flu. Would the bird flu be spreading at the rate it is now were it not for the globalization of the agriculture and food process? A lot of this has to do because you've destroyed, through globalization, local production of food. And you've created the conditions for the spreading of diseases, for increased mutation. Look at what's occurred through something like NAFTA. Under NAFTA, Mexico has lost 1 million farmers. Look what's happened to the farms in the United States as a result of NAFTA. No one has benefited from this. And so again, you've got to look at reality. That's why we say these things often become masturbatory. Because we can come up with all these fanciful ideas about, well, in the abstract world, this and that happens, and wouldn't this be beautiful and wonderful? But look at reality. Reality is in complete contradiction to everything that's been put forward in the absolute abstract. And so if, in fact, we are going to address the reality of the crisis we face now, a banking collapse, a physical breakdown of the U.S. infrastructure, there's been no laws which have dissuaded people from investing into water systems, power systems, and the like. So why do we have a collapse of our infrastructure in the United States? This is the reality we have to address. And right now, as a movement, with Lyndon LaRouche, with the LaRouche Youth Movement, we represent the only force right now in the United States and on the planet which is absolutely committed to the bringing back into existence of a just economic order, which will defend the rights of the nation state to promote the life, liberty, and pursuit of true human happiness for every person on this planet.
This debate has kind of taken an odd approach. On the one hand, you have logic. Logic is saying, man has rights. We tell you exactly where these rights come from. These rights come from his nature. These rights come from the fact that in order to survive, he must produce. He must create things that others find valuable. He must produce things that further his own life. Philosophically, rights are absolute. You have the right to your property, and you have the right to trade it freely, to gain for yourself, and to make your life as good as possible. Those are your rights. The government's there to protect those rights, to ensure that people do not steal from you, that if you have a contract with them for some good or service, that it is provided, etc. What does LaRouche tell you? They do not tell you anything about rights other than the fact that you have them. What are they? Blank out. Where do they come from? Blank out. They have no concept of what rights are, why they exist, where they come from, anything about them. They just say that you have rights. What are they? I don't know. Logic tells you exactly what they are. Your rights are to your property. They say that your rights are to other people's property, that you have the right to the property created by a bank. Or if you have a debt with a bank, it's your right to have that debt relieved. They say things like, we're going to, you know, re-regulate banks, and we're going to relieve debt in Africa in order to bring them out of poverty. Whose banks are you regulating? Whose property are you telling bank owners that they can, or when you say that a bank can't, when you say that you're going to regulate a bank, you're regulating someone's bank. You're regulating John's bank or Pat's bank. This is their property. This is not some abstract thing that just exists and it's like a tree and you just get to like tell it what to do. This is someone's property. This is something someone's worked very hard for, has invested a lot of time in. They do not address this at all. They just think it's something that like grows on trees. Like it's an apple and it's just like, that was just there. And it's just their job to like discover how best to divide it amongst everyone in the room who's hungry. No, this is something that someone planted. It's something that someone worked very hard to produce. When you just divide it up or tell them what they can and cannot do with it on their own, you completely remove any incentive that they have to do a good job with it. If someone does not have the right to run their bank how they want in order to maximize their own profit, you've wiped out their incentive to create a good bank. If you're just going to say that the debt, you know, that they have given to someone, the debt that they have voluntarily agreed exists between, like, when they loan out money to Africa, for instance, or a homeowner or anyone else, that debt is created, and those parties involved in the transaction have agreed that that debt exists. They both think it is in their mutual benefit, otherwise they would not do it. And when you tell one party that they don't have the obligation to pay that debt back, as LaRouche is advocating, you completely wipe out and destroy any incentive for anyone to loan anyone money ever again. If I make a loan to someone and I have no expectation it's going to be returned, I have no reason to give someone a loan. Because it's not a loan then, it's just a handout, it's charity. Banks are not in the business of charity. If they were, they would have no money. They would just give it all away and then dissolve. Banks are in the business of getting profit. Incidentally, it helps everyone, because banks serve a vital function in the economy. They also mention, you know, people have a right not to be laid off. To say, this is absolutely ludicrous. A job is the property of an employer. Just as an employer has the right to offer a job, to offer a wage, to offer a benefits package, to offer a place to work, or a thing to do, they have the, this entails the right to not offer it. And as soon as it becomes not profitable, not in the company's interest to offer that job anymore, they should take it away. Otherwise, they're being inefficient. This is not only a disservice to them, it is a disservice to everyone else in the economy. This is a disservice to their shareholders, it's a disservice to the other employees, it makes the business run less efficiently, less smoothly, and ultimately worse for everyone. They say that history is what we need to be looking at. History. They completely ignore philosophy. Where do rights come from? They do not address this at all. You want to learn about history? Like I just said, policies that were instituted in the under FDR during the Great Depression lengthened the Great Depression. I don't have the exact study with me, but it makes sense. Think about it. When the government just hands out money and says, go do with it whatever you want, and doesn't say, you know, you are only going to do things that, you know, you think are in your interest, or you should do something because a market exists and you want to develop it for profit, of course there's no incentive to do things properly. Take, for instance, electricity in the South. They said, you know, under FDR, it was mandated that companies lose money by investing in infrastructure for electricity in the South. It wasn't profitable then to do this. It should not be done until it's profitable for someone to do it. Because people in the South want electricity, there's going to be a market for it. It's just a matter of someone finding a way to make it profitable. And when someone finds a way to make it profitable, that makes it better for everyone. It makes it much more efficient. It makes society better off as a whole. Not to mention, it doesn't violate the rights of the people who own electric companies that are being forced to provide infrastructure to a place that doesn't have the money to pay for it. Ask them where they derive their source of power. They say that it's the government's job to do everything to satisfy everyone's whim and fancy. Ask them where the government gets that power. Logic tells you the government doesn't have that power. That you have the power only to do with yourself and your property, and you have the obligation to not force other people to do things they don't want to do with their property. They do not address philosophy at all. Please keep that in mind. Arthur has a couple things to say, so I'd like to turn over the mic to him for the last minute.
Yeah, as far as what happened with the Depression, the cause of the Depression was that the government told a bunch of banks, you can lend out more money than you actually have in reserve. So all these banks allowed, lent out a lot of money to people who wanted to invest it in various things. Now, when you have an unlimited amount of money or an artificially high amount of fake money to go ahead and spend on anything you want, you're more likely to be reckless with that money. So, in fact, what happened was that you had a lot of bad investments. People finally realized, gee, these investments are failing, and everybody realized that all of this money was backed by actually nothing. And so, lo and behold, the entire economy collapsed because everybody was cashing in all this money that actually didn't exist. So how did the government propose to solve it? How did FDR try to solve it? Why, let's let the banks give out even more money. This is, you don't fix a disease by cutting out the organ that it fixes. That was poorly worded, but I think you get my point.
All right, and this ends rebuttal period. Now LaRouche can make its closing statement.
All right, to close, I'll take a chance to make some more reading recommendations for people. People like a chance to see exactly what the necessities for production are, and not in broad generalities, but in specifics. I suggest Alexander Hamilton, the first Treasury Secretary of the United States, had three main papers that he issued to Congress upon coming into office. And these are the papers that laid the foundation for the development of the physical economy of the United States, and laid the basis for all of the United States' physical economic power that came thereafter. These were also policies that Franklin Roosevelt came back to in order to get us out of the Depression. The first paper is Hamilton's report on the public credit. The second is the report on the National Bank. The third notable one, to what's come up earlier in this discussion, is Hamilton's report on manufacturers.
and he opens his report on manufacturers. And this is the founding document. This is a document that created the manufacturing industry, industry inside the United States, which would have primarily been solely agricultural. And in that paper, he calls for regulation, he calls for tariffs, he calls for using taxation to distort the incentives that that private enterprise would otherwise find in certain kinds of activity. He calls for the government intervention to create sections of the economy that didn't exist before. Now, this is the actual history of the United States, and these are actual documents you can find. I suggest taking a look at those, because any debate that's taking place in the absence of those is taking place, again, in the fantasy world. There's reasons that we have laws against loan sharking in the United States. There's reasons that we have Chapter 11 bankruptcy laws in the United States. Because you've got, the government has a responsibility to manage the credit. And this is also Hamilton's point in his report on public credit. The government has a responsibility to manage the issuance and the distribution of credit. The way you do that is you police that, keeping in mind what's necessary for the general welfare of the population as a whole. Now, as for what defines the general welfare of the population, this comes up a lot. People are very backwards on this idea of property. It's notable that though people like to attribute, we'll come back to that. Man does not have, there's no fundamental right to property that humankind has. There isn't. The right to property in the United States is premised on the only reason that people have access to property in the United States is for the exact same reason people have access to credit. The government issues it. The government creates the possibility for any citizen in the United States, any private entrepreneur, to have access to that. And the government in the United States, with the government of the people, by the people, and for the people, the government which is the voice of the population, the voice of the voice of the general welfare, the way the population as a whole is capable of regulating the activity that takes place inside of it, the government has a right to say that has a right to take a look at the usage of property within its territory and say, well, is this doing something that's beneficial for society as a whole? And the government should do that. The government uses taxation policy to that effect from our inception, from the beginning, from Hamilton's first policies, that was the policy of the United States government. The government does determine what should be profitable, what should not be profitable by what the population needs. And the population has a say in that. That's why we have a representative democracy in the United States. People elect the representative government, and the elected representation makes these decisions. The metric for making these decisions should be human nature. Now, human nature is not, you've got one quality that distinguishes human beings from the rest of the creation as a whole. And that's that we've got the capacity to investigate and discover truths in the world around us. We can recognize paradoxes in our existing body of knowledge. And by recognizing but use that paradox as your doorway to a universe that otherwise wouldn't be accessible to you. And in that fashion, we can successively improve our knowledge of the universe around us. We keep expanding the truths we have access to. And that quality is what allows the human species to survive. That's the quality of the human species that allows us to discover new energy resources, which is necessary because there is no such thing as sustainable development. There is no such thing as renewable energy. Any energy resource that could be stated is exhaustible. People say, well, is solar energy exhaustible? Yes, you've got a limited amount of land area. There is material that goes into the production of solar cells. It's not simply sunlight. You don't absorb it and figure out how to apply it elsewhere. We're not plants. We don't do photosynthesis. There's a productive process involved in that. And because that's necessary, it's necessary to have the human species continually moving from resource base to resource base. It's necessary to have as many human beings in the population actively engaged in that process as possible. And the government has a responsibility to maintain that. And human beings have a right to take part in that process. And that's really the only fundamental right.
Hi, I mean, one thing, too, I thought was sort of funny what Arthur brought up
First, it was wrong when he said that it was the policy of Roosevelt that created the Depression, because the Depression was full-blown by the time Roosevelt came into office, number one. So it was Hoover that was there whenever the Depression hit, and they were the policy that came out of the Coolidge-Mellon administration. But then, two, the real funny thing was that he said what caused it was whenever the government deregulated banking, gave banking the power to issue more money, and then the private banks chose their own act of volition to then extend more credit, thus creating the depression that he says occurred. And so it just seems funny that he actually blew away his whole own argument about the role of the private banks and deregulation. So that was just a funny irony. Two, the argument they're making for private property is in fact, you want to know where you can find it? You want to go back and find where that argument exists? It's called the Confederate Constitution.
Oh, shit.
Life, liberty, and property. So what's being defended right now is in fact the doctrine of John Locke, which then showed up in the Confederate Constitution as a defense of slavery. And so I think it should become very clear to people, in fact, what you're witnessing here. You're witnessing a battle over that same ideology that was at the center of the Civil War, that was at the center of the founding of the United States, between those who believe that man does, in fact, have an inherent right to true human happiness based upon his nature. And in fact, it's not true that we haven't put forth philosophical ideas about the nature of man. We've been very clear in no mesh terms about the true nature of man with historical specificity. We know the true nature of man because we've gone through the rigor of investing the minds that have created the conditions of existence that we enjoy today. Such as we brought up before, Kepler, we can name others. We've worked on the works of people like Carl Friedrich Gauss, Gottfried Leibniz, Benjamin Franklin, Einstein, the list goes on. So until you've actually gone through the rigorous work of getting inside the minds of those individuals and knowing, in fact, how they thought, you really have no right to claim to know the true nature of man and to claim to know how mankind progresses. And so, again, we just have to keep coming back to the same old principle. Look at what's going on through deregulation. Is not the crisis that's occurring in Mexico right now a function of deregulation? Look what's happening right now in China. You still have people say, well, look at the great wealth we produce by exporting our industry over there. Nonetheless, you still have hundreds of millions of people in China who live in absolute squalor because the standard of living, because the price of exporting of goods out of China doesn't allow for the necessary capital formation to create the conditions to raise the standard of living of the people of China. The same goes for India. This policy of deregulation and outsourcing is the sole cause of the destruction of nations around the planet, and is currently at the center of the destruction of our own nation. And so as this reality becomes more and more clear to people, I think you're going to be forced to come find us on your campus and start to do some reading about what, in fact, can be done to reverse this economic collapse. And so just to make one last plug, in fact, for people who want to get more in depth into this, and I'd say this is could become an issue of debate. You can then find us on the campus and we can debate these points. But tomorrow, on our website, www.LaRouchePAC.com, at 10 a.m., there's going to be a live international webcast where there's going to be questions taken from state legislators, from congressmen, from senatorial offices. It's going to be a discussion between LaRouche and leading elements of our own government and national governments around the world. So check that out, and then let's continue the debate.
Logic, can you present its closing statements?
All right, I'll make a few quick points, and then I'll get to the real substance. Argument about what was in the Confederate Constitution, I'm sure it wasn't wholly wrong, like every 100% of the word, everything that in it was wrong. So the fact that some things happen to coincide don't make it wrong. I'm sure there's at least one thing No, I'm talking about the principle. That the principle is not necessarily wrong. Just because Hitler used the word vermin once doesn't mean that every person who uses the word vermin is doing the exact same thing as what Hitler is doing. So that's just one little point, as much as I disagree with whatever else the Confederate Constitution may have said. Now, as far as the FDR business, I never said that FDR created the Depression. I said that his attempts to fix it actually made it worse. In fact, with banks, we're regulating someone's bank. The government, when it says you may do, you know, you can lend out more money, that is not deregulation. That is allowing fraud. It is fraudulent to lend out more money than you actually have. The government was allowing fraud. That is a form of government intervention. This is why what they did was intervention into the economy, not allowing natural market forces to work where the initiation of force is banned. So it is no surprise then that that sort of policy is what furthered the Depression. Now, to the more substantive points, we're hearing a lot of talk about history. History is important, but history is not the basis of proper philosophical argument. History is littered with all sorts of facts. What scientific tests are you going to use to discover which facts of history are correct and which are wrong? You can argue about the facts of history all night and all day. How are you going to test them? It is impossible. Create what? Time machine? Come on. So the real question here is one of how the mind functions. Particularization or integration? What the LaRouche camp advocates is particularization. They want to analyze every single little detail of every single thing that ever happened, and mind you, incorrectly. But the point is, they're trying to particularize all these things instead of integrating them into one or a few consistent principles. Who can hold a whole host of facts in one's mind when determining whether or not to impose a certain kind of sales tax on certain import cars from a particular country, which may only last a certain amount of time? How can you, when you drop the process of integrating into principles, that which is the method of reason, how are you to come to rational conclusions about what government policies to adopt and which to reject? Now, another thing that has been said is that, I'll continue along the same point, that history is something that we need to study, and I agree. But history needs to be studied within the context of a proper philosophy. It is only by understanding what human nature is that we can discover what actual motivations in history are. Philosophy is something that doesn't require special research. Philosophy is something that is available to every man on his own terms. Once you have acquired a certain amount of experience in reality, that is, you've created the concept man in your mind, or you've created a certain vocabulary, you can think through yourself what correct philosophical principles are. You can discover on your own, without reference to, you know, looking stuff up in books, whether they're history books or statistics or studies or this or that. Statistics and studies, these are not philosophical arguments. These are not the things that you base principles on. These are things that you use principles to explain. So philosophy being available to every person and history being reserved for the elite who wish to study it, not that there's anything wrong with being elite. The point is that philosophy is something that each person needs to use and exercise, and this is how you get to philosophic truths. This is how you discover what the nature of rights are. It is not by doing a statistical analysis about cramming people into sardine cans and figuring out how many people you can cram into a small place of land and maintain a certain level of a certain standard of living, and they have education, electricity, and all these other sort of values. This is not how you form philosophical principles. And to that end, they think that values are somehow either subjective or intrinsic. Values presuppose a valuer for some goal. Electricity as such is not a value. Sunlight as such is not a value. These things can only be a value to some person for some goal. This is why they cannot try to regulate the economy in order to better electricity. The only people who are qualified to say that electricity is good are the people who use it and wish to pay for it. After all, if you want something, you should be willing to pay for it. Now, this is why we can now get into a question of property. Where does property come from? It doesn't come from government. Government doesn't create the right for people to incur credit or debt with one another. Granted, the government backs it in our current system, but it doesn't create the right for people to engage in trade. Rights presuppose government. This is why we need government. So when we talk about property, let's talk about not fantasy land, but reality. Man requires certain things for his survival. He does not just exist on his own in a vacuum. He requires food, home, along with other things, clothes, transportation, etc. The things that he creates or trades for, those are the things that become his property. This is the nature of property. It's not so much inherent to man as it is just a part of his nature. Philosophical distinction of the word inherent, maybe another time. But the point is that property exists because of the nature of man. Man survives by property. Now, when we talk about the government deciding on certain values, which somehow we think that people voicing what they want in the marketplace is not enough of a decision. People shouldn't be able to just pay for what they want, and if someone can provide it, they should just be able to provide it, free of any third-party coercion. We say the government decides. What does it mean, the government decides? Like I said in my opening, the government, society, is not an entity. A democracy cannot vote on value. Society as such does not value. There's only individuals that value. Individuals are the only ones who have a right to voice their desires or wants. They're the ones who in the marketplace can say, I want this, I'm willing to trade this in exchange. To say that the government decides is only to say that the government is your slave master. Now, how is that the case? Imagine, if you will, you are a homeowner, and someone comes to your home and says, I want your silverware. Okay, well, does he have a right to just take it? I mean, let's just say he goes to your home and takes your silverware, points a gun at you and says, give me your silverware or you're dead. So, does he have a right to do that? And I think everybody here can agree no. Not that your agreement is justification, but regardless, I think you can understand that it's no. If one person can't do it, what about 10 people? 10 people come to your home and there's just you living there. They're now a relative democracy. Do they get to take your silverware because they've decided amongst themselves and you're just one among 11? You know, they can now have your silverware? No. What about 100 people? No. 10,000? 100 million? A billion? No. There's no principle that changes when you suddenly have 51% of people decide, we want this person's silverware, or, as the case may actually be, your hard-earned income, or whether it's what you can do with your bank or your electric company or Microsoft or you fill in the blank. There's no right that a democracy suddenly has that is above and beyond what any particular individual in that democracy has. If one man cannot vote away the rights of if one man cannot just take away the rights of another, no democracy can do that either. We have said what rights are, where they come from, that they're based on human nature, that the root right in a society is that you may do anything you wish with your person and property, provided that you do not initiate force or fraud against the person or property of others. That is your root right. Everything else, you know, all the particulars are derivative from that. That is an integrating principle, not the, you know, infinite particularizations of, you know, well, in this historical example, there's this, whatever. If you study history correctly, you will discover that everything is consistent with philosophical principles. Philosophical theories can be good or bad on the basis of their conformity to reality. So if you start with correct facts of reality, that is, what is human nature, what is the nature of knowledge, and set with the nature of the universe before that, you can get to true facts of reality. And history will support that because you cannot practice logic on correct premises and get to an incorrect conclusion. So this is why when we say that human beings have rights, they're based on facts of human nature. These are the perceptual level facts that everybody has access to. Everybody can verify for themselves. We don't need to go and study history books. Though if we do, like I said, you will discover they're completely consistent with philosophy. This is why, during the question and answers period, you should not accept a statement from the LaRouche people that you have rights, and then a blank out as to what they are and where they come from. Ask them where rights come from. What are they based on? Why is society or stuffing people into sardine cans the standard for whether, you know, someone can be allowed to do something or not? How is that based on the nature of man? Ask them. You will see that the non-initiation of force in capitalism is the only system that is proper to man.
All right. That effectively respectfully ends our debate. We'll now be opening this up to questions from the audience. Although before we do that, first of all, let's just give one last round of applause to our debaters. If the course of this debate has hurt your interest in any of the groups, you can get more information about logic at the table to my left. And LaRouche also has a table set up outside with pamphlets about its organization. With that said, let's do the questions.
Yes, my question is
for I'm sorry, could you come up? People who would like to ask questions, would you please be so kind? But would you be so kind because
no,
we're recording this?
We should have it recorded.
Yeah, thank you. The general welfare.
Yes. I think what we'll do this is we'll let both groups address the question, even if it's if the particular question is still addressed at one group. That would be equitable. Just
go. My question is for the LaRouches, specifically pertaining to their assertion. Something about the bird flu being related to NAFTA somehow. So my question is, does the bird flu come over in the vegetables? Is that what's happening? Is there an element of free trade that causes the proliferation of diseases from one place to another beyond the movement of people?
Yeah, the free flow of goods, the shipment of goods. As I said, it wasn't NAFTA per se that's responsible for the spread of the bird flu. But I don't know if, But what you have is because you've destroyed a certain localization of the production of food, that you've got transport of unregulated, largely, transportation of chickens in particular that carry this bird flu. Now, this bird flu is also mutated to where it's been able to jump into other form, other birds and things, and so you've got, now because of that, a free flow of this disease. I mean, it's pretty much as simple as that.
But if this is contagious to humans, wouldn't humans be able to transfer it?
Yeah, and that's the thing. It is, humans can be affected by it. Now, there's still a lot of research that has to be done as to whether or not human beings can be carriers of it. Someone might have more specifics on that. But also the danger then you risk is that it can mutate. Diseases mutate. And so one of the dangers is that it will mutate into a form where you can have a human carrier.
All right, we're going to want to limit follow-up questions to allow opportunity for other people to also ask questions.
I mean, all I really have to say for that is logic completely agrees. Everyone should wear spacesuits. We should enclose the United States, every country in the world for that matter, in a giant biodome. And that'll protect everyone from every disease ever.
Problem
we completely agree with that. That makes a lot of sense.
We won't have any spacesuits because under the deregulated system, we're not going to have a space program.
All right. But this isn't supposed to be a banter, but let's put it this way. It is true that we would not have a space program that we have today because if we didn't have it regulated. But it would have come around on its own terms when people actually desired it, not because some people decided to vote to use the money of other people for this lofty scientific exploration. Now, a few points about this bird flu business. I mean, it is true that diseases can spread. They spread when people interact with one another. How do you think diseases spread when you pack people into sardine cans? I would say that your maximum potential of getting people into small areas. I mean, this is
that's a fallacy composition on your part.
All right. Regardless. Okay.
The thing is.
The debate is ended. Let's just get to our next question. Yes, please.
Hello, my name is Brent, a former objectivist, but now fighting with LaRouche. It's fun for me to be here. I'd like to situate my context for the logic club in the reality of the current hyperinflationary process we're experiencing, created by deregulation, meaning the absence of government intervention in the creation of credit by banks. Okay, my question, because the logical consequences of this hyperinflation that we can prove to exist, one such consequence would be, maybe your mom wouldn't be able to afford your government-subsidized education. You'd have to choose between that and food. My question is, how does the individual keep the banks open so that private industry can continue to make a profit?
I'm not sure what you're talking about when you say hyperinflation, because inflation has, for the last few years and probably even decades, been extraordinarily low, approaching zero.
I'll take that as your answer. Thank you.
No, it's not.
that was just the beginning of my answer. Just to say that your premises are false, that your question is non-existent, it's about the things that don't exist. But to further the response to something in reference to this